You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome back to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. Today, we're going to investigate the causes of terrorism. I recommend that you truly organize yourself for this particular broadcast, this particular lecture, because there is a lot of theoretical information and also a lot of current event information, a lot of political information. We are going to study the causes of terrorism from the perspective, theoretically, of criminologists, sociologists, and psychologists. But we're also going to look at some, events that actually cause people to justify terrorism, or what we would call terrorism, and also extremist behavior. So there are certain events that we're going to look at as case studies. If you have any questions, please feel free to phone in live or to send an email. The telephone number is 310-928-7330. And if you have any questions you'd like to send electronically, just send it to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So let us begin investigating the causes of terrorism. The first thing to keep in mind is that there are true causes for what we would call terrorism. Those who are on the receiving end of repression, for example, may feel as if they have no choice but to rise up and resist violently their repression or oppression. The photograph that you see on the screen right now is from the so-called dirty war in Argentina. And the dirty war involved an uprising, it involved a terrorist movement, but it also involved extreme government repression. So let us begin by looking at the roots of extremism. First of all, this concept of movements and dramatic or traumatic events. I want you to first consider what we mean by the term movement. What is a movement? You should consider it to be activism for change or to preserve something. A movement is not simply me having an opinion. A movement is not simply me and you, two or three people, going out and expressing that opinion. It involves mass action. And the mass action is not simply operating on an individual's beliefs. For examples of American moralistic movements include the civil rights movement, the Christian fundamentalist movement. They're both similar in the sense that they were trying to achieve the political high ground, the moral political high ground. Now, let us investigate dramatic or traumatic events. Firstly, there are two case studies that we are going to study, Black September and Bloody Sunday. The photograph that you see is the result or the outcome of Black September. Now, traumatic events. Think in terms of trauma within the history of an individual or a nation or a people. When we talk about traumatic events, we have to understand that these events can lead to future behaviors that we might consider to be extreme or terrorism. First of all, an individual's trauma. Imagine that you are in a particular society and that your people, that is your ethnic group, religious group, racial group, whatever, is under the control of an authoritarian government, or that your group has been actually targeted for some sort of repression by another group. So imagine that you are a child sitting at the dinner table and gunmen come in and assassinate your father. That child may grow up to resist those people who assassinated his father, even though that child may only be 11, 12 years old. There are many case studies like this. Secondly, a nation's trauma. Entire nations can be traumatized through invasion or through some other sort of violent incursion. For example, the invasion of Afghanistan by the Soviet Union led to a holy war, a jihad, in which the Mujahideen, the holy warriors of the Afghan people, rose up against the Soviets. But also what we saw were Mujahideen, or holy warriors, that came from other countries by the tens of thousands. We will come back to this case study several times later on in the course, and we will also look at this concept of the holy war later. But just understand that the nation of Afghanistan is still at war. Even though the Americans and NATO have come into Afghanistan and are fighting the Taliban, they consider the war to be the same one. First, they defeated the Soviet invaders, and now, from their perspective, they're resisting the NATO and American invaders. Or it could be the trauma in the history of a people. And by that, I mean an ethno-nationalist people, religious people, racial people. For example, the Kurds, the Kurdish people in the Middle East, are divided among four countries. But for unfortunate history, there would be a Kurdistan made up of more than 40 million people. But they are divided between Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Iran. The Kurdish people, many of them, have taken up arms. They're resisting to different degrees, different extents, all of those people, all of those nations who are occupying what would be, historically, Kurdistan. So let us investigate two case studies now. Remember these. These are excellent case studies. The first one is called Black September. Black September occurred in September of 1970. And we'll come back to this case study. This is when the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine attempted to hijack five airliners. We have to understand that prior to Black September, the Palestinian resistance was a classic guerrilla war that was being fought against Israel. Guerrilla fighters would cross the border, and they would attack Israeli targets, then go back across the border into Jordan. They were using Jordan as a safe haven. The world ignored the Palestinian cause, ignored the Palestinian struggle. So, in September of 1970, there was an attempt to hijack five airliners. Three succeeded. One of the ones that failed was the attempt was carried out by a person named Leila Khaled, who we'll come back to later today. We'll talk about her several times because she is a case study of one who, you know, from our perspective, we've always referred to her as a terrorist. From the Palestinians' perspective, though, she's a freedom fighter. So we'll come back to Leila Khaled. The three airplanes were flown with 255 hostages to Dawson's Field in Jordan. The PFLP, the Popular Front for Liberation of Palestine, released all of the hostages and blew up the airliners, the planes, which we'll see in another class in a video. The photograph you're seeing is Dawson's Field. That is Black September when they detonated their explosives. Interestingly, they waited until the media had arrived. And interestingly, they let all 255 passengers free. This is an example of the old terrorism. They were not deliberately, in most attacks, going for high body counts for mass casualties the way modern terrorists do. In the modern era, in the year 2019 plus, the hostages would have been executed inside the airplanes. So the times have changed. The new terrorism is more deadly in that sense. Now, after these incidents occurred, the Jordanian army attacked Palestine Liberation Organization bases in Jordan. Major fighting broke out, and the PLO was expelled from the Kingdom of Jordan. Their headquarters moved to Lebanon and to other places, and this led to a chain of events that continues to this day, frankly. This completely politicized the Palestinian people. The Palestinian people, in their minds, are fighting against Zionist occupation and against injustice. Now, a second case study is Bloody Sunday. We're going to see a video involving Bloody Sunday in a moment. But just understand one thing about Bloody Sunday. And there's a parallel that we can draw to the United States. There are two incidents known as Bloody Sunday. The one we're going to look at is from Northern Ireland, but there was another earlier Bloody Sunday in the United States in Alabama. On March 7th, 1965, there were three marches from among the civil rights movement where African Americans and their allies were marching from Selma to Montgomery to protest the fact that African Americans could not vote in the American South. 600 protesters crossed a bridge, the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama. They were met by the local sheriff department, who began to beat them. And it was a bloody encounter. Horses, people were trampled by horses. Some of the county sheriffs actually wrapped their billy clubs in barbed wire and began hitting people in the head and in the face with these barbed wire wrapped billy clubs. Now, the response of the American political establishment, though, was in favor of the protesters. President Lyndon Johnson, 1 week later, on March 15, 1965, gave a speech in front of the American Congress and actually used the phrase, "We shall overcome." So the American political establishment favored this particular movement. Now, compare that to Bloody Sunday, and we will understand a stark difference between the Bloody Sunday in 1965 in the United States and the Bloody Sunday on January 30th, 1972 in Northern Ireland. The Irish Catholic population was attempting to imitate the American, African-American civil rights movement. Many of the marches were peaceful. They had 10,000 people in this particular march. People were literally singing, "We shall overcome," in Londonderry in Northern Ireland. 10,000 marchers were met by British paratroopers from the 1st Parachute Regiment. And the British paratroopers opened fire on them. They killed 13 marchers and wounded many others. The video that you're going to see right now is a video that demonstrates the political result of that. In the United States, the American civil rights movement continued largely peacefully from the point of view of the protesters, but in Northern Ireland, the Irish Republican Army literally had to turn people away at the door because the Irish population rose up in a true rebellion. So what you're going to see is the outcome of Bloody Sunday in Northern Ireland right now, and what you're going to see is the beginning of the Troubles in Northern Ireland. So let us go to the video now.
Thank you.
we see here is how a true rebellion can begin if repression is violent and people see no other means. So when we talk about the causes of terrorism and extremism, remember Black September and Bloody Sunday as representative examples of how an entire people can rise up. One thing to ponder, just intellectually, is what would have happened if the sheriffs at Edmund Pettus Bridge in Alabama had opened fire on the demonstrators, and there was no political response from the president or Congress whatsoever. That would be an alternate history that we can discuss. Now, let us continue. We're going to look at several things. Firstly, revolution as strategic choice. And then we're going to look at sociological explanations of terrorism and psychological explanations of terrorism. And we will discuss case studies within each one of these particular categories. Now, let us begin by looking at political violence as strategic choice. Beginning with this concept of making revolution or an act of political will. You should ask yourselves, what is an act of political will? And then we're going to look at adversaries in the war on terrorism, because the different sides view their struggles very differently. The extremists, the people who we consider to be terrorists, have a very different perspective from what we do. Now, let us look at the acts of political will. Remember this, understand this. When you talk about strategic choice, this means that it's a rational strategic choice to force change. Terrorism is simply a tool of many, one among many, to achieve a desired goal. And we will look at Marxist revolutionary thought just as an introduction to this, but just understand that when we talk about terrorism, very often it is simply a strategic choice. In some respects, terrorism is a poor person's warfare. From their point of view, anyway, it is a poor person's warfare. It is simply a tool to achieve something. Now, all one needs when you talk about political will is the will to keep fighting, to hit, to run, to fight forever. And the theory is that if you have that kind of iron will, then victory is inevitable. Remember, we think that a long war lasts for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. The opponent, though, may consider this to be a generational kind of endeavor in which they raise their children and grandchildren to continue the war. So understand this concept of political will. It is actually very powerful when one considers why some of these events are protracted. Now, firstly, let us look at Marxism, just as a case study, as an example. Karl Marx, of course, invented Marxism. I suppose if one creates an ideology, you may as well name it after yourself. He believed that capitalism is rotten and will inevitably be destroyed. This is history as a scientific law, that it is inevitable for class struggle, class conflict to occur. And Karl Marx thought that this would be natural, that it would just happen. Well, it did not just happen. So along came Vladimir Ilyich Lenin and his comrades in Russia. They believed that the revolution would have to be given a push, that capitalism is not as rotten as we would like, so the door would have to be kicked open through a violent revolution. There's a concept that we're going to come back to called the vanguard of the people. He believed that an elite had to lead the people to revolution, to victory, and that this vanguard would be represented by an educated elite, by what he called the Communist Party. So what we will see in a future lecture is that this was actually a fairly effective or fairly potent concept. Then, and we'll come back to this, then lastly, Mao Zedong. Understand Mao Zedong and this concept of so-called people's war. Mao linked military strategy with political strategy. And in the modern era, religious extremists do exactly the same thing. So yes, Mao was a communist and followed in the same footsteps as Lenin and Marx, But remember, this particular strategy is still being applied by religious extremists and some others. So remember Mao's People's War. This concept of the conceptual roots of what we're talking about. First of all, Mao Zedong operated within the countryside. It's rural guerrilla warfare. And rural guerrilla warfare, we could consider this to be globalized in the modern era. People's war meant that an entire people was at war, not just an army whatsoever. He believed that there was a rather simply understood strategy behind this. Firstly, indoctrinate the troops, which means a particular fighter can be completely uneducated, but they will know why they are fighting. Then, secondly, one should win over the people. The people should be treated correctly. They should understand that this is a liberation army that is amongst them, which means that the people who are with the particular revolution will be treated correctly, treated well. Those who oppose the revolution, though, would be treated very harshly. But the idea was to win over the people after indoctrinating the troops in how to treat them correctly. And then, lastly, this idea of hit, run, and fight forever. What this means is that the war will never end, that it may begin, but there is no end point. They know that if they're being occupied, that occupation army will eventually go home. And frankly, you know, we have gone into several wars in which we announce we're not going to be there forever. Well, our opponents just have to wait us out. For example, in Afghanistan, this is our longest war so far, but the Taliban are not giving up. They are still fighting, and they're just waiting us out, essentially. So within all of this, the concept is that, as Mao Zedong said, revolutionaries are fish that swim in the sea of the people. So think about that. They are fish that swim in the sea of the people. They disappear. During the day, they may be farmers or workers or shop owners, but at night or at other times, they are fighters in the revolution. They disappear within the sea of the people. So there are small roving bands or cells that occasionally unite for a particular hit. There are never pitched battles against a stronger enemy. It is simply a matter of hitting and running. There is no shame in running. It is expected that one would run. They melt into the hills, melt into the villages and towns, and melt into the people, the sea of the people. Within this particular people's war strategy, assassination is perfectly acceptable. The assassinations are directed against soldiers and police, government administrators, so-called tools of the oppressor. Remember that this kind of fighting occurred during our particular occupation of Iraq. It was a true guerrilla war. We changed the language. We called it an insurgency and called them insurgents. But our opponents were guerrilla fighters fighting a classic guerrilla war, and they disappeared among the people. Symbolic show trials and executions are expected. These show trials are expected to show the rage of the people. They tend to be essentially just ritualistic executions, really. But what would happen is the people's army, if you will, would simply put on a show trial of putting an enemy administrator on trial. The people would shout abuse at this person, and then they would execute this person. We've seen this repeatedly. And finally, disruptions of government-sponsored programs and events are very important. Bombings, etc., are used to destroy infrastructure. They are tainting everything that the government touches. This is a very effective strategy. They are trying to show that the government is helpless and corrupt. So the insurgents, the guerrillas, will actually destroy the good things that the government has done. Schools, oil pipelines. One thing that happened in Iraq during our occupation, the American and their allies' occupation, was the insurgents systematically blew up their own oil pipelines and oil depots. You would think that this would go over very poorly with the people, but what it showed was, in their minds, from their perspective, that the occupation armies and forces are weak, or were weak. That was the idea behind this. Unfortunately, there was talk, there was rumor, before or as we were going into Iraq during the war, that we would pay for our war with Iraqi oil. The rumor may or may not have been accurate, but it caught on. It went viral, and so the Iraqi insurgents did begin to attack their own oil supplies. Now, keeping all this in mind, when we talk about political choice or strategic choice and political will, we have to understand the perception and cultural disconnect in the modern war on terrorism, the adversaries. The perceptions are, from the Western point of view, that this is a war against Western-style civilization. You know, there were rumors after 9/11, after the attacks on September 11, 2001, that they simply did not like our prosperity or our democracy or our freedom, and that was the popular talk anyway. The fact is, from the non-Western perspective, though, there is an imbalance toward Muslim countries vis-a-vis Israel. Firstly, that's a baseline. Secondly, it is the behavior of the West that is the cause of angry sentiment in the Muslim world. And if you think about this, that is very accurate in the sense that we do have troops who are based in the Middle East. We have our Navy that is based in the Red Sea, Persian Gulf. We have, during the war in Iraq, we were based in Saudi Arabia when we were liberating Kuwait. But secondly, in the war in Iraq, we had bases throughout the region. They believed that these were occupation forces, that these were the return of the Crusades. And if you listen to the rhetoric of the other side, they refer to the Western forces as Crusaders and Jews. This idea that this is a war on Islam, from their point of view. Now, we can debate that, but the bottom line is that there was a report from the Central Intelligence Agency in 2007, which was very prescient. It was very accurate in its own way. The analysis said that the invasion of Iraq created a new training ground for the holy warriors, the Mujahideen, for those who are opposed to Western interests, that this was a similar training ground as we saw in Afghanistan during the Russian or Soviet occupation of Afghanistan. And this report was accurate. It is the behavior of the Western democracies that is actually, it was one reason for pushing the successful propaganda that our adversaries have. If you have any questions, I encourage you to phone in or to send an email asking the questions. If you do not have any questions live, please send them in and I'll address them in the next segment, the next broadcast of this course. So please feel free, I know this is a lot of information, to feel free to phone in or send an email or electronic question. Now, there is another explanation there's a battery of explanations. This is a group of explanations. When we look at political violence as the fruit of injustice, here we're going to explore sociological explanations, criminological explanations, and psychological explanations. The photograph that you see on the screen is an American soldier in Abu Ghraib prison in Baghdad dragging a suspect by his neck. He's completely nude, he's naked, dragging him with a leash. These photographs from Abu Ghraib prison during our occupation of Baghdad and Iraq went viral. They're all over the internet now. When I mentioned before that sometimes the reasons for strategic choice, terrorism is a strategic choice, the reason is that it is the behavior of the West. Well, this is a prime example of that. These American soldiers were prosecuted, they were courts-martialed, but the damage was done. One could imagine that this individual is being dragged by a leash eventually took up arms against the Americans or their allies. So, let us now explore sociological explanations of terrorism. And this is, again, this is the fruit of injustice. So this is theory, so please bear with me. The idea is that intergroup conflict leads to collective violence. There are two broad categories for this, structural theory and deprivation theory. Structural theory simply says that there are social conditions that affect a group, the group access to societal benefits. And here's what that means. It simply means that there are benefits in society, but there are structures in place that prevent everyone from joining in from enjoying those benefits in society. These structures are considered to be oppressive by one group and beneficial by another group. In addition to that, there is a broad category known as deprivation theory. Deprivation theory is one that we should keep in mind because it's quite logical and it may have some merit. There are two kinds of deprivation that you should keep in mind: relative deprivation and absolute deprivation. Relative deprivation refers to deprivation within a society that has a great deal of prosperity, economic benefits, opportunities, but not for everyone. So the idea here is that those who are deprived are relatively deprived. They are not necessarily starving. They may have some access to medical care, just not as good as the majority group. So relative deprivation refers to places like the prosperous Western countries, such as the United States. We have homeless people in the United States. We have poverty in the United States. Now, compared to other countries, this sort of poverty may not be absolute. But having said that, you compare, for example, Skid Row in Los Angeles to Beverly Hills. Just drive through in the morning at Skid Row and drive through in the afternoon in Beverly Hills. That is what we mean by relative deprivation. Some people are completely deprived compared to our very wealthy segments of society. Now, secondly, absolute deprivation. We can understand this fairly easily. There are areas of the world in which people are struggling to survive. They may not have clean water, for example. They may not have access to education for their children. They may not have medical care for their children or for themselves. They don't know if their children will live to reach adulthood. In a society where someone is absolutely deprived, we can understand that perhaps they might pick up the gun and the bomb because they have nothing left to lose. So in this explanatory category, this idea of deprivation refers to violence being the product of intergroup conflict. It is a strategy of the weaker group, and the disadvantaged group is asserting its rights. At this point, this should be no revelation to you. So this is based on perceptions. This particular sociological explanation is based on perceptions of different groups. The weaker group perceives that there's an opportunity for change. They perceive that perhaps the government is weak, the government is brutal and corrupt, and that the people, the broader group of people that is either absolutely or relatively deprived, they are ripe for revolution. So we are going to take a look at a short video that looks at the rise of Islamic State in the year 2014. If you understand the rise of Islamic State, you will understand sociological reasons for terrorism and insurgency, because Islamic State, as violent and brutal as they were, they actually had a great number of supporters. And many people from the West and from other Muslim countries also came in to support them and joined them. So let us look at this video as a sociological explanation of the fruit of injustice.
Yeah. Just when you thought the Iraq problem was solved because you haven't heard about it for a while, everything's back to murderous chaos and terror. What happened? In 2003, the US invaded Iraq because of its alleged connections to terrorism and weapons of mass destruction. At the time, Saddam Hussein, a brutal dictator, ruled the country. He was part of the Sunni minority and suppressed the Shia majority. Iraq was conquered fairly quickly, but the US had no plan for the country. The until then suppressed Shia majority took over and began oppressing the Sunnis because suppressing other faiths has proven to be such a good idea. Unsurprisingly, a Sunni rebel uprising began and terrorist groups like Al-Qaeda trickled into Iraq and local forces, often former Sunni military, began fighting the US troops and the newly formed Iraqi state, peaking in a bloody civil war in 2006. Since then, people in Iraq have basically been segregated by religion. So, in a tragic irony of history, the US invasion led to the formation of the very terrorists the US wanted to eliminate in the first place, because Iraq was now the perfect training ground for terrorism. To understand this complicated conflict better, we need to understand the relationship between the two main branches of the Muslim faith, Shia and Sunni Islam. Sunnis make up about 80% of the Muslim world, and Shia about 20%. And the hardliners on both sides don't like each other very much. Saudi Arabia and Iran are the two most powerful players in the game of faiths. They both have no separation of state and religion, domestic problems, and a lot of oil money. And they support groups that fight the other religious orientation. And one of those terror organizations supported by Saudi Arabia was the Islamic State in Iraq, or ISI for short. In 2010, the Arab Spring happened and changed the whole situation in the Middle East. In Syria, dictator Bashar al-Assad didn't think much of resigning and started a gruesome civil war against his own people. The longer the war went on, the more foreign groups joined the fight, most of them for religious reasons and with the goal of building an Islamic State in the region. And one of them was the infamous ISI, which now became the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, or ISIS. They had fought in Iraq for years and had thousands of well-trained and fanatic soldiers. They already quasi-controlled parts of northern Iraq and were very determined to build their religious state. And they changed the game in Syria like no one expected. ISIS was so unbelievably violent and radical that soon it was at war with almost every other faction of the Syrian rebel armies. They attacked and killed members of other Muslim terrorist groups. In the territories they controlled, they built an Islamic State with rules so strict that even the hardliners of Al-Qaeda and Saudi Arabia were shocked and withdrew their support. ISIS has been accused of responsibility for multiple massacres against civilians, countless suicide bombings, the hostage taking of women and children, the execution of their prisoners and beheadings. All kinds of medieval horrors we would rather not have to illustrate. And this lovely gathering of human beings recently decided it was time to take more territory in Iraq. Since the US left Iraq, the Shia Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki has monopolized power and discriminated against Sunnis wherever possible. The government of Iraq is widely regarded as being corrupt, incapable, and it's certainly hated by a large part of its citizens. The Iraqi army, consisting of about 300,000 soldiers, was created using $25 billion in tax money, but it's not loyal to its government and has been withdrawing or completely disbanding, giving up city after city. Because ISIS has announced that everyone who opposes them will be killed, they have proven they mean business. By June 2014, they'd conquered a big chunk of Iraq, including Mosul, Iraq's second largest city. They'd stolen hundreds of millions from captured banks, making them the richest terror organization on Earth. And they are constantly working on establishing a super medieval religious state. Iran and the US are even considering working together to fight them. That's how gruesome the situation is. Events in Iraq show again that exploiting the people you've defeated in a war, denying them power, a living and a stake in the rebuilding of the country, is just sowing the seeds of the next bout of violence. Somehow, we have to break this circle.
This was a good summary of what we mean by sociological explanations of terrorism and extremism. Islamic State, of course, was and is extraordinarily brutal and violent, but it has reasons for its existence that are rooted within conflicts that occurred in Iraq and Syria and elsewhere. So just understand that even though we certainly are, from our perspective, are opposed to groups like Islamic State, they have their reasons for being in existence. Let us now explore. Let us summarize sociological explanations of terrorism and explore several groups. I just want to mention these, actually. The first one is the Irish Republican Army, which we have mentioned. Their constituency are the Northern Irish Catholics, and their adversaries are British and Ulster Protestants. ETA is a nationalist, or was a nationalist organization, which engaged in terrorism in Spain. Their constituency were and still are the Spanish Basques, and their enemies were the Spaniards, who they considered to be occupiers. There are Palestinian groups, both secular and religious, and they favor the rights of the Palestinians, and their enemies are the Israelis, who they consider to be occupiers. The FLQ was a violent extremist group in Quebec, in Canada. They favored the French-speaking residents of Quebec, the Quebecois, and their enemies were the English-speaking Canadians. So these are typical sociological explanations, as is the rise of Islamic State. Now, let us look at criminological explanations. I just want to mention this because they are very similar to sociological, but I just want to mention these because we're talking about here the path to political criminality. All terrorism is criminal. So this is why there are criminological studies that have been done on the reasons for terrorism. I just want to mention these because they are very theoretical, but you should keep them in mind. First of all is the concept of differential association theory. Differential association theory is a process of social learning. It simply says that both criminals and law-abiding people learn their behavior from associations with other people. So people imitate and internalize their associations. They strive for similar goals, but choose different paths, either legitimate, law-abiding paths or criminal ones. So if you inject politics into this concept of differential association is an explanation, a theoretical explanation for political violence. Secondly, enemy and strain theories. This is a focus on the availability of goals and means. The idea is that everyone wants similar goals. We all have the same goals, but the acceptable means may differ. So, an acceptable means would be having a job. An unacceptable means would be robbing a bank. But from the perspective of someone who's inclined to rob a bank, it's perfectly acceptable. Routine activity theory simply refers to a convergence of three societal elements. There is a steady supply of motivated offenders. There are a ready availability of attractive victims and targets of opportunity. And then there is the presence or lack thereof of social guardians, such as the police or courts or others. And then lastly, radical criminology. Understand one thing about radical criminology. It originated, it grew out of Marxist theory, actually, in the United States. Radical criminology says that deviant behavior is caused by society's inequitable ideological, political, and socioeconomic makeup. So inequality causes deviant behavior. It causes crime. So in the minds of some radical criminologists, criminals are victims of society, that society has conditioned them to become what they are. We are going to now begin psychological explanations of terrorism. But before we do, we're going to take a short break, a short 5-minute break, and explore each one of these. Terrorism as a psychological condition is one that we hear quite frequently. But we'll explore whether this is actually accurate, the sense that only a crazed person would engage in terrorism or a bombing. Well, it's much more complicated than that. So let's take our break, and then we'll return and look at psychological explanations.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life, and a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Danaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Thank you and welcome back. If you would like to phone in any questions, please do so. The number is area code 310-928-7330, or simply send an email to the address on your screen. Now, let us continue with our conversation about the causes of terrorism by looking at psychological explanations of terrorism. Now, psychological explanations of terrorism refer to essentially rationality and terrorist violence. We're going to look at several psychological explanations, beginning with terrorism as rational choice among alternatives, and then terror as a way to maintain group cohesion, and then the psychological justifications of violence, and finally, the Stockholm syndrome as a case study. Now, firstly, the concept of terrorism as a rational choice among alternatives. There have been psychiatric studies done of captured terrorists, and this goes back for decades. There have been these studies. So you should think of the struggle, the revolutionary struggle, as having a menu of choices. Some are violent options, some are less violent options. The violent alternatives are things like acts of vengeance, violent acts of vengeance. It could be perceived as a last resort that grows out of frustration or impatience. There are less violent alternatives, such as taking the abuse or negotiating a solution or just trying to reform the system from within. But that it's a rational choice. And this is, some of these psychiatric studies of terrorists going back decades have shown that they rationally chose to engage in political violence. Next, terror as a way to maintain group cohesion. So understand that this is when violence is used as a way to promote group solidarity. Group solidarity is intended to overcome individualism, that one is giving one's entire life, entire being, to the struggle, to the revolution. This brings together, that is, the violence is considered to bring together a people or fellow believers. The actual group can be made up of diehards in a struggle who refuse to recognize a truce or agreement, or they are refusing to surrender. It's often a last gasp. But the bottom line, though, is that the violence maintains the group. And they believe that victory is inevitable. There's no logical or actual victory, but they believe that if they continue the struggle, they'll win. Next, the psychological justification of violence. So we have already said that the target, the victim, is depersonalized. Violence becomes a cleansing act. Buildings are attacked with people inside. Executives and others begin to represent corporate interests. They stop being mothers or fathers. They become capitalists, imperialists, Zionists, colonialists, and it goes on and on. So a label is hung on the victim. And the victim is considered to be worthy of possibly execution, of being killed. So this is a psychological justification of violence by relabeling someone, essentially dehumanizing human beings. It makes it easier to rationalize violence against those particular human beings. I would like you to consider a condition called the Stockholm Syndrome. The Stockholm Syndrome is an interesting case study that comes from an incident that occurred in August of 1973 in Stockholm, Sweden. There were two bank robbers who were foiled in their attempt to rob a bank, and they took four hostages. There was a six-day hostage crisis that occurred during this foiled bank robbery. What's interesting, though, is during the six-day siege, the police did not come in. They were just waiting them out. They gave them food, water, but they were just going to wait out these particular bank robbers. So the bank robbers engaged in perceived acts of kindness. In other words, from the hostages' point of view, there were perceived acts of kindness. The hostages were told by the bank robbers that they would be shot in the leg and not killed, that they should play dead because the police were actually going to come in and kill everyone in there, but they would mercifully just shoot them in the leg and they should just pretend like they were dead. There was one individual, one hostage, who had claustrophobia. She was let out of the vault on a rope leash and then pulled back in from time to time. All of the hostages, all four of them, began to sympathize with the robbers. They became loyal to the robbers for months afterwards. They denounced the authorities publicly after they were released. So they refused to testify at first. They raised money for the defense of the bank robbers. And interestingly, one of the hostages actually became engaged to marry one of the robbers. And the question is, why? Why did this happen? There's been a great deal of writing, a great deal of research put into how hostages react to their environment. The idea behind the Stockholm syndrome is that if one is completely helpless, then one can begin to identify with the person who is keeping them helpless. So that's the idea behind the Stockholm syndrome. It is debatable. There's no question. There's some skepticism, a great deal of skepticism about this. But the fact of the matter is that we have seen repeatedly that hostages, after they are taken, have often either joined or at least spoken very kindly of the hostage takers. We will investigate later the Symbionese Liberation Army and the case of Patricia Hearst. She was taken hostage and she was abused, but she joined them for more than a year after they actually met their demise. We'll come back to this case study. Let us now look at a very important concept and a very important study that was done by an individual named Franz Fanon, who you probably have not heard of. This is terror as esteem building. Very important concept. And you can see the photograph of Franz Fanon, and this is the cover of the first edition of his book. And this was written during the 1960s, the early 1960s. It's entitled The Wretched of the Earth by Franz Fanon, and at that time its title was A Negro Psychoanalyst Study of the Problems of Racism and Colonialism in the World Today. This study is still very relevant for the current environment. Now, here's what we mean. It's an important concept. This book was very influential for politically violent people. It is used, or was used, this concept was used to justify political violence. So think about this, self-esteem. Think about the concept of self-esteem. Well, we all have some form, some level of esteem. Franz Fanon was a psychiatrist. He was from the island of Martinique, which is one of the French-speaking islands in the Caribbean. During the 1960s, he went to Algeria and became one of the chief propagandists for the National Liberation Front in Algeria, which was fighting against the French occupation, the French colonial occupation of Algeria. One thing to keep in mind is that Algeria at that time was viewed as being part of metropolitan France, the same way that for the United States, Puerto Rico is part of the United States, the United States Virgin Islands are part of the United States. Well, the French considered Algeria to be the equivalent of that. And so there were many tens of thousands of French of people from mainland France who settled in Algeria. They were considered by the National Liberation Front to be colonialists. So Franz Fanon went to Algeria and he had written The Wretched of the Earth. He began to a concept known as liberating violence. And he said the following in The Wretched of the Earth. He said, "Violence is a cleansing force, freeing the colonized from their inferiority complex and from despair and inaction. It makes them fearless and restores self-respect." Let me just read that one more time. Just understand this. Violence is a cleansing force, freeing the colonized from their inferiority complex and from despair and inaction. It makes them fearless and restores self-respect. In other words, one is not free unless they engage in violence. Violence is a liberating force. Terror and atrocities are needed. They are necessary to throw off the chains of oppression. He believed that oppression is in the mind. This concept of mind-forged manacles, that there are chains in our minds that we must break and throw off. He believed that violence, that is political, anti-colonial violence, whatever you want to refer to it as, was necessary by the oppressed. So the poorest of the poor becomes stronger than the strongest of oppressor, simply because of this liberating violence. And those of you who are philosophers may see a strain of French philosophy in this. Existentialism, which says that, of course, we are all born, but we don't really exist until we find ourselves later in life. Then we exist. Well, Franz Fanon took that and said that the poorest of the poor do not exist until they actually engage in liberating violence. So this explains atrocities. This clarifies codes of self-sacrifice. It is a purging force, a cleansing force like a fire. And so Frantz Fanon is very influential. And I'll just give a personal anecdote. I went to my neighborhood Starbucks, and I saw someone there, a young man sitting there reading The Wretched of the Earth, and he was reading it very intensely. So I walked up to him sort of intellectually, in an academic way, and I said, "Ah, I have that book at home. I've read it. What do you think of it?" He looked at me as if I was from the FBI or the CIA, simply because I knew it was in the book, and he knew I knew it was in the book, and he thought that perhaps I was watching him, because this book is truly a revolutionary book. There's no question about that. Now, let us explore morality. Let us explore moral justifications for political violence. We have looked at the social sciences, sociology, psychology, criminology, but let's look at morality now. So we're going to explore several things. We're going to look at the moral convictions of terrorists, the simplified definitions of good and evil, and then this concept of seeking utopia. The individual that you see on the screen is Leila Khaled, she's Palestinian. We will come back to her. She is literally a poster child for a revolution. This photograph you see was found in college dormitories during the 1960s and on into the 1970s. She was a Palestinian revolutionary, and she was held up as a symbol of revolution at the time. And we will look at codes of self-sacrifice. The codes of self-sacrifice are very important to understand because they are moral justifications for extreme violence. Now, beginning with moral convictions of terrorists and extremists. This refers to moral clarity. The idea is that terrorists have an unambiguous certainty in the righteousness of their cause. Unambiguous certainty. They have a moral clarity. And they achieve this moral clarity in different ways. Two of the primary reasons are that, firstly, a particular group concludes that it has been morally wronged by an immoral, evil enemy. Powerful forces are arrayed against them. The evil forces are arrayed against them. They feel betrayed and exploited. They can have some legitimacy. There may actually be a history of oppression or repression. The outcome is excessive resentment, but they feel that there's a moral clarity to their cause. The second way is that a particular group concludes that it possesses an inherent moral superiority to an enemy. You see this repeatedly. A particular ethno-nationalist group, a particular race, a particular nation just believes that it should be taken for granted that they are morally superior to their enemies or to any other group. This is the essence of racism, the essence of believing in the one true faith, that God favors a particular group over other groups. It goes on and on, but this kind of moral clarity arises from a sense of superiority. Which brings us to simplified definitions of good and evil. Simply put, and it's easy to understand, that a clear line is drawn between good and evil. It means that we are right, they are wrong. There are no gray areas. Violent methods are justified by the ennobled goals of the cause. So what this means is that some individuals in a nation or a group can be indoctrinated to believe this. They can be indoctrinated by society or raised within society, by their parents and others, to believe in this sort of simplified good and evil. Or an individual can come to believe it. They see things a certain way through a certain lens, and they just come to believe that they have a clear idea of what good and evil are, and there are no gray areas. It is just simplified. And then, this concept of utopia, seeking utopia. In other words, it's a moral end that one achieves through violent means. Think about what utopia is. It is the perfect society. The perfect society that one self-defines. So the promised good outweighs present actions. The end justifies the means. So think about this. The revolution, the struggle, will bring utopia. Everything good will come after the violence. This is particularly popular among ideological extremists, racial extremists, and religious extremists. They truly believe that the current generation has to undergo a cleansing fire, more or less, that the violence is absolutely necessary to destroy the current society, and then on the rubble, the new utopia will be built. And that this is inevitable. This is simply necessary to be done. We will come back to nihilism and come back to anarchism later. But there's a stream of thought that continues through the modern era. So, in other words, in a sense, when it comes to seeking utopia, one can say that this is a form of faith, whether it is political faith, religious faith. The idea is that this favored group will destroy the evil society that exists now to bring something good in the next generation, in the future. Let us now explore a concept that I would like you to remember forever. This idea of moral purity, a code of self-sacrifice. This refers to superior codes of living that cleanse those who follow the code. Before I look at our case studies, we're going to look at three case studies. I want to just give you a mainstream view of a code of sacrifice or a code of living. And I'd like to refer to boot camp. Those of us who've been in the military will understand the purpose of boot camp. And you've heard this phrase. The individual is broken down, and then they're filled back up. The idea is that they break down, the drill sergeants, whoever it might be, the military will break down the prior indoctrination, the prior upbringing, and then fill them back up with a new indoctrination, a new upbringing. This is not necessarily a bad thing, because in order to become a good member of the military, a good soldier, one has to be well trained. One has to be well indoctrinated in order to carry out possibly some very intense, very serious missions, or very intense or very serious livelihood. Now, if we can do that, that is, if mainstream militaries can do that, so can extremist nations, extremist societies. So this is a profile that I would like you to keep in mind, because extremists and others consider this to be a superior code of living, superior to other codes of living. Those who follow the code are superior to those who do not. The code accepts a certain truth and applies it to everyday life. So this could be a religious, an ideological, or an ethnic or racial kind of code. The first code I would like to bring to your attention, and these are all recent codes of self-sacrifice, is the so-called Waffen-SS of Nazi Germany. You can see this on the screen. This photograph are members of the so-called Waffen-SS in Nazi Germany. They were racially selected. And by the way, you can see the on the sides of their helmets, the double lightning bolt, which means SS. These were racially selected soldiers in Nazi Germany. I mentioned this rune because you can still see modern neo-Nazis with these double lightning bolt tattoos on their shoulders and necks or whatever. So these were considered to be racially selected Aryans. The concept of an Aryan is a racially pure Northern European superman, superwoman, that they are racially superior to other races. So they were trying to create a master race and trying to return to a primeval or primal past. So the SS were racially selected, and they were more or less the imperial guard of the Nazi regime. They were strictly indoctrinated. They were hard-fighting soldiers. They were used as shock troops. Those who fought against them considered them to be fanatical. But though, if you listen to the interviews of former SS soldiers, they will say, no, we were just hard-fighting, indoctrinated members of a certain racial code. So they had the best weapons and best provisions. They engaged in a racial crusade against Jews, against Slavs in the East, against the Poles, and against others. Heinrich Himmler, the leader of the SS, said the following to a group of SS officers. He said, "You have seen the bodies by the hundreds and yet remained decent fellows." So think about that. You have seen the bodies by the hundreds and yet remained decent fellows. The SS managed the concentration camps. These so-called decent fellows would literally go to work in the morning and kill hundreds of people. And then they would go home and listen to music, associate with their families, and relax, and then go back the next day and do exactly the same thing. So this particular code is a racial, violent code. The Nazis killed about 26 million Russians. The SS were known to completely obliterate certain towns and villages throughout Europe, and then march away, singing marching road songs as they were marching away from the massacres. So this is a good case study of moral justification for extreme violence. A second example of a modern code of moral purity is Japan's code of Bushido. Japan's code of Bushido during the Second World War was an upgrade of the old samurai code. The word Bushido means warrior's way. And the Japanese society, the Japanese army and military were indoctrinated very similarly as the SS were in a complete superiority of their culture, their army, and their purpose in life. It was a return to the code of the old samurai. The samurai were of course, a warrior class that believed in obedience, devotion, and discipline. According to some reports, the concept of bowing during this era, in which someone would bow to a superior, meant they were presenting their head to them as a form of obedience. So what you saw was literally a cult of the sword. And the Japanese pilots, for example, would take antique swords into airplanes with them. Clearly, they're not going to use them, but they did. The photograph that you see here is actually a result of the code of Bushido. We will come back to an incident known as the Rape of Nanking later. What you see here on the photograph is Japanese soldiers engaging in bayonet practice against captured Chinese soldiers. In other words, they're demonstrating how to properly dispatch someone with living soldiers that they had captured. The Japanese army killed about 13.6 million Chinese during the war. They were absolutely ruthless. And even though 1 in 20 American prisoners of war died in Nazi prison camps, 1 in 3 died in Japanese prison camps. They had absolute contempt for surrender. So when we look at this, remember that when you look at the actual history of this, in modern Japan, they tend to deny the extent of the result of the Code of Bushido. There is some debate in Japan about whether the Rape of Nanking actually happened. We'll come back to the Rape of Nanking because it is an historical fact. The next code I want to mention is a modern American code, and it is the Ku Klux Klan's racial code. We're going to spend some time on the Ku Klux Klan later when we come back to the terrorism in the United States, the case study. But just look at this photograph. This is a racial code in which a particularly racist organization believes that they are racially superior to people who are different from them. And they tie it in with their own interpretation of Christianity. They believe that they have a racially blessed condition within the eyes of God. And of course, we all know that they burn crosses, although they say that they light crosses to bring the soul of Jesus Christ back from the world of darkness to bless them. We'll come back to the Ku Klux Klan later in greater detail, but I'd like to show you a short video right now which explains very briefly the racial code of the Ku Klux Klan. It is an interview by a journalist named Jorge Ramos with a particular Texas Klansman, and just listen to what the Klansman said. He is clearly convinced that he is racially superior to Jorge Ramos, and he explains, he summarizes what he means by this. So let us go to the video now. It's a short video, and take a look at this racial code of superiority.
Hello? So where are we, Rowdy?
We're just out here at a safe place.
The safe place from?
From whatever.
Could you explain to us who are they and what it means, the robes that they're wearing?
These are Nighthawks. Mm. Security.
You're armed now? Do you have a rifle or a gun now?
I don't know. Really.
Are they armed?
I don't know, are they?
I'm just asking.
I'm just telling.
You say the Klan does not believe in equality or integration. What do you mean? You don't believe that everyone is equal?
No, no. White people are so much higher than any other race.
Excuse me?
White is so much higher than any other race.
How can you say that? Based on what?
I just said it. That's how I can say it.
Yeah, but based on what?
Based on God. We're God's people.
Isn't that racism? Precisely
racism? That's not racism. That's fact.
Do you believe that you're superior?
Yeah.
To African-Americans?
Whites are superior over every race. No doubt about it.
Do you feel superior than me simply because I'm a Latino?
Oh, yeah. Sure do. I'm not saying you're a dumbass or nothing like that.
No, but you think you're superior than me,
right? But I think my race is better than your race.
Well, actually, Latino is not a race.
Well, whatever you want to call yourself.
It's a different ethnic group.
Whatever you want to call it. So let's go to another subject, okay?
I saw a video that you don't believe that 6 million Jewish people were killed during the Holocaust.
Sure don't. But let me ask
but
you this.
Well,
let's
that
talk about this.
But it doesn't
no,
mean that
you want
it didn't
to talk
happen.
About the Jews,
it didn't
the
happen.
Scumbag Jews. Let's talk about what they did.
No. Let's talk about the fact that you're denying
no,
a
they,
historical
they,
reality.
They crucified their women, raped their women.
No, we're talking about the 6 million
I know
Jewish
you only
people.
Want to talk about the bad
no,
things.
No, something
about
something
what
that
you
you're denying
about.
And it's absolutely wrong. The facts are completely different.
Oh, really?
Yes, of course.
Well, I mean, you have your views. I have my views. Let's not go to the nasty ass Jews, okay? I don't even want to talk about them. Let's talk about the country, okay? If you are one of them illegals over here, you have no rights at all.
As a human being, you have rights. I don't call them illegals.
That's nonsense.
Well, for you, it might
How
be.
Could you
but
even
it is important to say,
way.
It is important for me to
Common
say that
sense,
no human being is
it's
illegal.
It's important for you to say this. It's a lie.
It's
you're
it
sitting there lying to me.
No.
Yeah, you, no, you're lying to me.
This is our country, too.
Oh, it ain't your country.
Of course it is.
No, it ain't.
It is our country.
You think it is?
No, it is our
no,
country.
No, it's not your
I'm
country.
Also a U.S. citizen. You're also a U.S. citizen.
You may be a U.S. citizen. It's not your country. When did you come over here?
In 1983.
Hey, how many years did our ancestors build this country up?
So what you're
but
saying...
But you want to come over and you want to say it's mine.
No, I'm saying that it is ours.
If you want to sneak across this border illegally, You need to go to jail.
Can you deport 11 million people?
Yes, you can.
How?
Arrest them, send them back.
11 million.
If it was 11 million and one.
How? Just
I guess
imagine.
I heard Trump's going to do it, so I guess he'll show you.
So if you meet one of them, what would you do?
I don't know. What would you do?
I would help him. I know what they went through.
Only thing I'd help is that boot in his ass to get back across that border.
That's violence, Roddy.
That's not violence. I didn't say I was going to kick him in the ass.
You just said that. You just said that.
Well, I probably said that.
You did. Do you think that violence is justified at some point?
No, we're peaceful.
So you would not use guns or rifles, or you would not
Use everything we can. We'll use a rope.
Thanks for talking to me.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, what you've just seen is a very candid conversation with a member of the Ku Klux Klan who truly believes in racial superiority. And that code, in his mind, actually does not pretend hatred of any group that he is opposed to. It simply means that he assumes his superiority for against other people. So let us do this. Let us now look at profiles of certain individuals as case studies. We're going to look at three very well-known individuals who are defined as terrorists. Ilich Ramirez Sanchez, also known as Carlos the Jackal, Sabri Albana, also known as Abu Nidal, and Leila Khaled. Before we do, we're going to take a short break, and we'll come back and we will finish by looking at these three case studies. If you have any questions, please feel free to call at any time, and we will now take a break and come back and finish by discussing these three individuals. Thank you.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Danaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hello, welcome back. Let us now finish our investigation of the causes of terrorism by looking at three case studies. Once again, we're going to look at three individuals, Ilich Ramirez Sanchez, Sabri Albana, and Leila Khaled, beginning with Ilich Ramirez Sanchez. And Ilich Ramirez Sanchez is a fascinating case study, in part because he's so famous. There have been several movies, several films made about him, and there have been books written about him, including a novel called The Jackal. Now, one thing about that we have to begin with is that you notice that Ilich Ramirez Sanchez's name, his first name is Russian. He is Venezuelan. His father and grandfather were communists, and he had two other brothers named Vladimir and Lenin. So there you see his father named his three sons, Vladimir, Ilich, and Lenin. Carlos went to a university of sorts in Moscow called Patrice Lumumba People's Friendship University. At that time, the Soviets were trying to bring in as many people from the developing world and elsewhere so they could meet each other and become radicalized and perhaps go back and carry out extremist behaviors. Sanchez, also known as Carlos, went to Beirut, where he joined the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. He had met members of the PFLP when in Moscow. He adopted the nom de guerre of Carlos because he thought it sounded like Khalil, apparently. And he also was eventually, they called him the Jackal because of a book that was written called The Jackal. So he became known, as come down to us, as Carlos the Jackal. Carlos was apparently responsible for at least 83 killings, personally responsible for 83 killings. In other words, one could almost argue that he was a politicized or political serial killer. He eventually was captured by the French. He had disappeared into Sudan and was captured by the French, and he's now serving three life sentences in France. We will come back to the case of Carlos later, but just understand that what we have here is a case study of a truly international revolutionary terrorist. He fits the, he is the model for this kind of individual. The second person I want to mention is Abu Nidal, who was also became very notorious. Abu Nidal, his name means, that is Abu Nidal, means father of the struggle. He became violently active after the Six-Day War in 1967. He formed his own organization called the Abu Nidal Organization, the ANO, but it is also known as Black September. Black September became perhaps the most notorious international terrorist organization of that particular era. It had several hundred followers and a militia in Lebanon. It was a splinter group of the Palestine Liberation Organization. He was actually more radical than the PLO. He split with the main group in the, of the PLO, Fatah, because of Fatah's use of diplomacy. Fatah, which was headed by Yasser Arafat, actually assassinated one of Abu Nidal's leaders. So they formally split. They engaged in mutual assassinations, but very importantly, the Abu Nidal organization, and also known as Black September, was often used almost as a mercenary kind of terrorist movement. They attacked people in at least 20 countries. They killed or injured about 900 people, some of them quite spectacular. For example, an attack in simultaneous attacks in 1985 December at Rome and Vienna at the LL counters within those airports. That LL is the Israeli airline. So he's very mercenary. He's favored by Iraq because of his affiliations with the Ba'ath Party, which is what Saddam Hussein was a member of. And he visited other countries like Sudan. In 2002, though, he had been given safe haven by the Saddam Hussein regime. He died in Iraq. So in 2002, he died of several gunshots to the head. And it's still unclear exactly what happened, but it's quite possible he wore out his welcome, and either it was self-inflicted gunshots, which he did rather than being taken into custody, or perhaps Saddam Hussein's regime assassinated him. Either way, Abu Nidal has come down in history as a good example, good case study of a mercenary international nationalist terrorist. The last case that I want to mention is the case of Leila Khaled. Leila Khaled is interesting because she is a good case study of someone who grew up in the Palestinian diaspora. And what I mean by that is this. She was 4 years old when her family was expelled from Palestine after the foundation of the State of Israel. She and her family, along with thousands of others, went into exile. Her family went into Lebanon. So she was very conscious of politics at a young age. She has written a book called My People Shall Live. In the book, she says that by the time she was 15 years old, she was a confirmed revolutionary. When she was 23 years old, she hijacked her first airliner and forced it to fly over her home city in Palestine, which is now Israel. And she landed that airliner in Jordan. In order to avoid detection or identification, she underwent plastic surgery. And she later participated in the Black September hijackings that we have mentioned before. Her particular attempt at hijacking was unsuccessful, but she was with a Central American comrade who was killed during her attempted hijacking. The point to remember about that is that these extremist groups were internationalized. They talked to each other. So you had a Central American comrade participating with the PFLP attempted hijacking. She is now living in Amman, Jordan. She is a bit of an elder statesperson within the Palestinian movement, the nationalist movement. She is married or was married to a physician, and she's a former member of the Palestinian parliament. And she does speaking tours. Now, the question is, of course, that one needs to consider is, was she a terrorist? Most in the West would say certainly, of course she was. But as far as we know, she did not personally kill anyone. She just engaged in these operations. But she's viewed as being, from the Palestinian point of view and in the Middle East, as being a freedom fighter. So she is a good example of someone who grew up within the milieu of struggle, of political struggle. And she is a case study that we will come back to. We'll actually hear a short interview with Leila Khaled. If you wish to access the study site, it is easy to find. It is in your textbook, and it is also on the PowerPoint slides. So please go to the study site if you need further information. And feel free to contact me at any time if you have questions. The photograph you see here is from Northern Ireland. What you see is a young boy holding plastic bullets. Those plastic bullets were fired during riots. You can see the debris in the background. And again, when we talk about the causes of extremism, the causes of terrorism, think of this young boy. He's growing up in this kind of environment, this kind of atmosphere. And one never knows how individuals who grow up in this kind of atmosphere, like him, like Leila Khaled, like other people, how they might be, what kind of adults they might become, and whether they might adopt the extremist tendencies within their particular environment. So, I wish you the very best, and tune in next time when we will study state terrorism. I'm Gus Martin for Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. Have a good week.